Hello, I am Argamowich. I am a VTuber, and my model was made using Vroid Studio. I am going to be teaching you the very, very basics of using Vroid. The first thing you're going to want to do is go to vroid.com/en for English slash studio. It should look something like this. You'll want to click the download button. It'll take you down to the bottom, which will show you which version you're about to download. Download the appropriate version for yourself. Keep in mind that Vroid Studios updates quite often, but does not do it automatically. You need to re-download the program every time it updates. To find out about its updates, you can follow them on Twitter. Once the program is finished downloading, it will have placed a zip file on your desktop. You're going to want to open that and extract its contents onto your computer. Once that is done, just simply double click on the folder, open it up, and you'll see the Vroid Studio executable file. Once you click on it, this should launch something that looks like this. You'll see sample avatars up here. These are great to experiment with and just get an idea of how certain things were made. But you're going to want your own original model. So you're going to do Add New Avatar. It'll give you an option for a female model and a male model. The difference between these models, besides the obvious one has breasts and hips and the other does not, is that the female models are given an extra set of expressions once exported. The male model also has more options when it comes to adjusting the face shape. Besides that, it really depends on what you're looking for. We're going to go with a female model today. Click on the female and let it load in. Now, this menu can look very intimidating, but I assure you, everything is fairly straightforward. Let's talk about interacting with your model. You can use the middle mouse button to grab and move your model around the screen. You can use the right mouse button in order to spin your model. And the scroll wheel to zoom in and out. The first menu that we have over here is the face editor. This will focus solely on the face. Over here on the left-hand side, you'll see two tabs that say design and texture. For right now, we're going to stick in the design section. The all tab will show you every single option, but that's a bit daunting. So let's go one by one. We'll start with the eyes. The eyes allow you to adjust how big or how small you want them based on these sliders and where you want them positioned on the face. Think of it as creating a sim or any avatar in a custom video game. You can make really big eyes or really tiny eyes. And it's always good to experiment because you never know what you might come up with. It might be something unique and original. Or something you never knew was possible. The next one down is the eye shape. This will allow you to adjust the basic shape of the eye. Following is the brows. Allow you to adjust the slanting and the frowning of the brows and the position. Then the nose, which for the most part is very limited on a female model. It'll always be this small side nose here that you'll see, whereas with the male models, you can at least change the width. And then you have the mouth, which for the most part, just allows you to adjust narrowness and width along with where it's positioned on the body. The ears have more options. On top of being able to do large and small ears, they now give you the chance to do elf ears and position them how you'd like. We're going to stick with normal ears this time, and slightly smaller normal ears. We have the face contours, in which you can adjust exactly what the face looks like. If you want it like a round face, if you want a more sharp anime face, if you want to make it a slightly bigger, this is where you can do that. Let me readjust the eye shape a little bit. This is something that I would recommend just playing around with until you feel comfortable with it. You could spend a lot of time playing around getting the custom avatar you want. From the face editor menu, we're going to move over to the body editor menu. I know this is quite a jump, but the hair editor tends to be the most complicated. We're going to scroll out and take a look at the body. Like the other one, on the left-hand side, you have design and textures, and it starts out in all, showing you every single option. But I recommend starting one at a time. So you can make a character short or tall with the height. Give her a little height. The head allows you to adjust the size of the head proportionate to the body. I tend to make mine slightly smaller. You can also adjust the neck this way as well. And the head width if you want it slightly narrower. Shoulders just works on the broadness. Now they both say broadness, so you'll just have to click and adjust which one is the way you want it to go. Sometimes Vroid doesn't translate things very well, and it can be slightly confusing because they'll use the same word for the same sliders. Just try each slider out and see what they do. Arms allow you to adjust the arms, and you can get some pretty crazy proportions in this program. Hands as well, which they now offer a finger thickness, so if you have a younger character, you might want to have thicker fingers. And hand size. Or slightly smaller hands. The bust size allows you to adjust the size of the bust and how it's going to be facing. So if you give her big breasts, you can adjust which direction they're facing. You can adjust how far apart they are and how close they are. One of the problems I see is that people tend to go for the largest size, and it doesn't necessarily look very proportionate to the body, but to each their own. There's also two smallness sizes. One is for the base, and one is for when it's using clothes. When it's using clothes, it has less of a jiggle, I've noticed. If I want to make a small child, I tend to use the female bodies to give them that rounder proportion, and I just use the breast at the smallness so it doesn't have the breasts. It just doesn't have the breasts. And I might also do this for male children as well. You have the waist where you can adjust the torso height and the volume of the hips. It says waist, but it really only means how big they can make the hips. Leg and foot are also pretty self-explanatory. We'll go there and we'll make her feet just a little tinier. So she's a little leggy. The following is the clothing editor. You'll see some options over on this side, but this isn't what you want. You want the options on the right side. You'll see the category clothing with tops and bottoms. So you could do none and it'll show the base skin type. You can choose from a variety of pre-made base outfits. And then you can customize these outfits to your liking later on. And the more clever and creative you are, the more interesting outfits you can come up with. But let's do the long sleeve for now. There are sliders here that allow you to adjust how these look. If the slider is not over on the side, like if you want to make this sleeve much longer and it's not over here, it's not possible to do within Vroid. It's something you'll have to take outside of Vroid. Bottom is similar to where, you know, you can change from wearing the skirt to uniform pants. And they even have the white version of the pants. So we're going to stick with the white version of the pants. Back on the left-hand side, in the lower area, there's category. There's clothing, accessories, and shoes. The accessories, for in this case, is the tie or the ribbon. And those are the only two options that they have in all of these. I assume in future releases, official releases, they'll have more options, but for now, that's all they've given us. I'm going to remove the necktie for this one. You can click on shoes and change the types of shoes that there are. You might notice that sometimes when you select a particular shoe, the toes will pop out of it. You'll want to go over on the right-hand side, it'll say toe shape. If the toes pop out, you're going to want to adjust from either flat angle to an angled foot so it pops back in there. You usually can adjust the sole height as well. And since we gave these low sole shoes, you can see that the angled feet are now popping out of the bottom. So keep that in mind. And the difference between barefoot and socked foot is if it shows toes. You can see the toes outline here with the barefoot. But with the socked one, it rounds it off for you. Let's go with the sneaker socked. And this is the outfit that we're going to start with for this particular character. But before we get into that, let's go back over to the hair editor. This is where a lot of the customization can be had. Over on the right hand side, you'll see design, bone, and texture. Along with the presence tab. The presence tab allows you to import pre-made hairstyles. We will not be using that. Instead, we're going to look at the hair group. There are two types of groups you can add, a freehand group, which you draw on yourself, and then a procedural group, which brings in a clump. We're going to work with procedural group. So you click on that and you'll see that a group of hair has appeared. You'll also notice that a right-hand column has shown up. This is divided into various sections. The material shows you the texture or what the hair will look like. You can adjust the color of a base hair using this top material tab. If you want to change the texture itself, you'll have to go into textures, but we'll touch on that later. Let's give her like a pink hair. So the base color is going to be that, which means I'm going to want the shade color to kind of be more red. The highlight color, if you go white, it's going to be extremely bright. So I'm going to bring it down to somewhere in the grays here, more brown. And the outline is if you would like an outline on this, what color it would be. For this, I'm just going to put in a dark red. Next on the list is the parameters. This is going to show you how the texture is going to apply to each hair strand. It'll show you where it's located upon the hair strand and how it moves up and down, or how it wraps around the hair strand. These might be a little confusing, but it's best to just move these to what appeals to you. I'm going to close, sort of minimize these while we work our way down. Next is the hair parameters. This will show you the individual hairs and how they're going to react. So you have the width to make really wide hair or bring it down to make really skinny hair. The thickness is the same, just going in the opposite direction. You can twist your hair from here. And this will tell you how many intervals you're doing of this twist and where it's located. And the smoothness. Now, I recommend leaving the smoothness where it is, unless you're working with very detailed textures. Next down is the cross section, which is if you look at a strand of hair straightforward, it'll look like a diamond, or you can make it look like a triangle or a flat, a piece of paper. And they also have unfilled triangle. Unfilled means it doesn't have the back half, so it's hollow. Let's go with the diamond shape for this. And then we have a curve. That's this line here. This can be adjusted manually, but they have some presets in there, such as fluffy, so it starts from a small tip, gets thicker, and goes back down to a small tip. Straight, which is pretty flat, starts a little small and expands thicker. Squid, which is thin, it gets big and then tapers back off to the tip. And then Ika-chan, who has these little arrows on her hair. Pretty obscure reference, but there you go. For this one, we're going to go back to straight because that's what I'm going to be doing with this particular hair once we start working on it. Next you have the guide parameters, which is this mesh thing that you're seeing around here. You can make it long or short compared to where you want it. The offset is how far away from the head and close to the head it is. So you can like pull it far away or tighten. For the most part, you're not going to be using this. The conformity allows you to adjust how it's going to match the front and the back and the side by side. Next, we're going to talk about the procedural parameters. The materials, textures, hair, and the guide is something you'll see in both freehand and procedural group. This procedural parameters is only in the procedural group, which is going to show you how to adjust this hair. Right now we have the length at 100%, which brings you down to the mesh. The position will allow you to move it around the head. The interval will show you how will allow you to adjust how close each hair strand is together. The center X will allow you to move the hair center on the X axis and the Y on the Y axis, which can give you some pretty interesting effects. The number of hairs, of course, allow you to add more hairs to this to fill it in or make it less, depending on what you're looking to do. For this one, I'm going to fill it in. Thickness, dispersion, these three are all named the same, but what it's basically saying is that it's going to change. Let me lower this down so you can actually see it. The thickness of each of the hairs and how it's spread out, so that way they're not all the same thickness or in the same location and they're clumped together differently. This is really good when you're doing boy hair, shown hair, or any hair that doesn't naturally fall flat. Since we're doing something that's closer to a bob on this, I don't actually need these particular ones. I'm gonna bring this back up so we can see it. It doesn't show up, but any other time I would recommend using this. There's also a parting length, which allows you to adjust like where the part is. And then parting side volume, which is something you'll use if you have parting length on. I never use these. parting sight as well. Tip curliness is one that I do use, and that pulls in the back of the hair or the front of the hair. So you can kind of move which way it's going, like how the hair is going to flow. And this I use a lot. This is one of my most used ones. Flow direction I don't use too much. It's how the hair will twist on the body. And I'm sure you could do something interesting with this, but for the most part, it's not needed here. Flow convergence is one that I do use, and where it pulls the hair back towards a tip. This is usually used for something like long hair, if you want it to flow out and to come together at a point. For this one, we don't need it. Flow curve, again, it's a lot like the flow direction. And then you have like the position of where it is on the hair. And you can do some interesting effects with it, but this is not something we need right now. All right, so this is how we've decided we're going to be using this hair parameter. Let's talk about this little toolbar over here. The top one is the select. Once you hit the select button, it'll bring up this grid mesh with these green dots on it, and it'll allow you to select each individual hair strand. The green mesh here allows you to adjust how the hair is going to interact. So if you want the hair over in one direction, if you want to make it longer or shorter, if you kind of want to try to make a wavy hair with it, that's what this will do. Now let's say that you want both sides to move at the same time. You want a symmetrical hair. You're going to click this little mirror button over in the top right corner. If you click that button, it'll allow you to move both sides at the same time. And that's what I'm going to use for this one. So I want to slowly make her hair into a bob. Pull this out and we'll pull the bottom ones in. So the hair has like this slight S shape to it. Perfect. The next one down is the brush. You cannot add a brush stroke to the procedural hair group, but if you try, it'll give you a brush freehand group on another layer, which will match the same mesh that this is currently. So you'll notice that this looks the same. Although you do not need to make it stay the same, you can adjust this hair accordingly. The next one down is a retouch button. This is a kind of a brush that'll allow you to fix messed up strokes. So let's say that we have like this wiggly thing and we wanted this straight. If you use the retouch, you can redraw this line and it'll allow you to kind of adjust it to where you wanted it to be. But we don't actually need that. So I'm gonna hit Control Z to undo what I've just done. The final one is control points, and this will show you the points of the individual hair strand. And you can grab each point and move it where you'd like it to be. Now, if you have two mirrored sections and you have the mirror tool on, you can move a control point and it'll move both sides at the same time. If you've moved one even a little bit and you put that mirror on, it'll no longer recognize it as a symmetrical hair strand. This is good for finer details. When it comes to adjusting the hair group itself, unfortunately, you can't really reorder them. But if you right click You get some options, such as toggle visibility, so you can make the hair disappear, or you can just click next to it and then a little eyeball will appear, make it appear and disappear. There's clone, so you can duplicate the layer, and then you can adjust the second layer to do something else. So we will just make the hair, do this, and this. So now she has a little bit of a wild hair. Let's see. There's also convert to a brush hair layer. Once you do that, you can edit individual layers. So we'll go convert to a brush tool layer. Now it's a freehand group. And now you can even draw on this layer without it adding a new layer. Or you can edit individual hairs where before you wouldn't be able to this extent with like the control points. There we go. There's also a flip option in here, which I'm going to show you what that does. If you take, let's remove this hair group real quick and let's hide this particular hair. So we only have the one. So let's say we've made one half of the hair and we are like really happy with it. We're just like, that is the best. We do this and we do this and we're like, yeah, that looks really good. Now I want that on the other side. So if you clone it, you can then right click and do flip and it'll match it to the other side. And that makes it super easy and simple to do. And we'll just bring all this back in, this crazy hair that we got going on back in. Let's say that you were working on a procedural group, this hair in the back is still procedural, and you decided this isn't exactly how I want this to look. If you click on the select tool in the procedural group, your guidelines will come back. And then you can readjust things. Like, let's say I didn't want it to be that big, I wanted it to kind of like go to a point at the bottom, you just adjust the control points. And that adjusts the shape. Basically, this is what the hair would look like if you cut it in half. All right. So that just gave her some front fringe. Now, as it stands now, if she walks, her hair has no movement whatsoever because we need to add bones. So if you remember, over on the left-hand side, there is a bone tab. You're going to click that, and this is going to show you all the bones, or all the hair strands that we can add bones to. If we highlight this first one, the procedural group, we'll see exactly where the bones of this group are going to go. So I'm going to click that and hit create bone group. And you'll notice this menu pops up over on the right hand side. You can adjust this particular bone, which is how it's going to move. These are where all the joints are. And we're going to lower it, at least for mine. The fixed point is going to show you where it's going to start the movement. So if it's up here, it's going to start at the very top of the head. That's not a natural movement. So we're going to move it down towards where the base of the head is. The stiffness will hold its shape, as opposed to allowing it to freely move around and being affected by physics and gravity. The gravity basically gives it physics. It allows the hair to fall down with weight, and when the head tilts, it'll move side by side. The hit radius, are these little balls here. And what it really means is this is a collider. So if other things come in contact with these balls, they will try to avoid each other. So let's say I had long hair. I would use these to avoid it clipping through the shoulder so the hair doesn't cut right through the shoulder. For this particular one, it doesn't need to be too big because the hair is fairly short. Now let's say you only wanted to select a few hairs at a time. Like, let's say I just wanted these two hairs and I want to make that a group. You can just select it with your mouse. You can do create group and then adjust how you want accordingly. Or if you don't want to be bothered with any of this, you can go down over to the generate bone group. I'm going to right click and delete these bone groups real quick and show you that you can generate a bunch of different bone groups, as many as you want. Let's do 20. And the fineness we'll do, we'll also do 20. And then we'll do generate bone group. And that'll basically turn all of these into their own bone sections. It might not work perfectly and you might need to adjust them once you see the avatar in action. Which we can do by going over to the camera, which is the last tab at the top. It's camera and exporter. This is where you can give your avatar some movement. You'll notice some options over on the left-hand side, such as face expression, which allows you to let your character have expressions. There's background, so you can change the background color. Pose, which allows your character to do simple poses. This is also a great place to see how the bone groups look. I personally do walking, as it gives it a nice bounce. Let's say that you are a female model, but you want to use a male pose. Over on the right hand side, you can just click the drop down menu and do a male animation. Or they even have poses that you can adjust yourself. There's a lighting tab over on the left hand side that'll allow you to adjust the lighting. The wind, we'll blow in some wind. Post effect is a great place for when you want to adjust things for taking a picture, such as anti-aliasing, which gives a slight blur to the edges so they're not as sharp, and it makes it more appealing to the eye. A bloom, which is a glowing effect, kind of a romantic effect. Color grading, which allows you to adjust the colors, the temperatures, and then the hue, saturation, contrast, so on. Comic allows you to try to make it look semi-comic-like, where shadows are using a tone or just lines. And you can even remove the color so it has no color and is completely black and white. It's fun to mess around with this. And then blur focus allows you to adjust where you're going to bring your focus by blurring the outside. These are fun little after effect things you can play with. Capture size is what this particular window is if you decide to take a photo of it. And which you can do down at the bottom. There's capture and a stop. So quickly, let's go back to a pose. All right, so we have her moving here. Let's say we want to take a picture of her doing this. You'll just hit the stop button at the bottom, and then you can hit the capture, and it'll pop up with a window that allows you to save your picture. Also in the camera and exporter, we have the export button. This is where you can make your model into a VRM to be used for tracking programs. You just hit the export, fill in the information here, and then hit OK. Finally, there's upload to Vroid Hub. You have to have a Vroid Hub account, and then it'll allow you to select the different images, enter the text, and it'll upload it to the internet for you. We're not going to worry about that right now. Let's jump to the general editor, because we have not talked about the general editor yet. That is the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5th button at the top. You'll notice that there's a couple of options over on the left-hand side, such as outline, rim lighting, shading, eye execution, excursion, and spring bones. For the outline, it's going to show you how thick outlines are on the model. So you can make it look more cartoony with thicker lines or remove them completely to definitely get that 3D look. So we're going to just give her thicker outlines like that. Rim lighting is this bright light you see around the edge, the light on the rim of the model. You can adjust that using these sliders. In my opinion, most amateur models have rim lighting, and it's very distinct and noticeable to the point where it's one of the standout traits of an amateur Vroid modeler. You can use rim lighting, and you can use it effectively. But when starting out, I recommend to turn it off. The shader will allow you to adjust the darkness and how sharp the shade is on the body and the hair. So if you do hard sharpness, you can make it close to a 2D style shading. Or if you do a soft shading or sharp, If you do a softer hardness, it'll give you more of a rounded 3D look. This is much easier to see on things like the face. So here you can see this shadow, and it is giving a hard light as you would a flat 2D object. But if you lower it down, it smooths it all out. And if you make it even wider, and adjust it accordingly, you can make it look more 3D-esque. Same with the body, which I'm going to just mimic the same settings. Eye excursion is going to adjust where the eyes will default face. So let's say we want her looking up just a little bit more and facing outer a little bit more. But you can adjust these however you want, so her eyes are all over the place. But this is how I think I want this particular model. For the most part, I don't even bother with this one. Spring bones is something fairly new that you can adjust how the physics will act on the body. It makes the dress or the clothing either a weaker spring bone or a stronger spring bone, so it doesn't move as much, or it'll move much more. Same with the body, and this is mostly for chest jiggle. So I'm going to go over to pose and put in a walking so you can kind of see like where the jiggle is now for both the dress and the body. And we're going to move the body all the way down, and we're going to move the dress all the way up. And you'll see how there isn't as much movement up here, but there's a lot more movement down here. You can keep it right in the center-ish, and you'll get a little bit of both. Alright, that's some of the basics, but let's talk about adjusting the way your character looks so it's not using the default everything. So let's go back over to Face Editor. And if you remember, we have these texture tabs in every single one of these. Let's click on it. So here we have what the inside of the mouth looks like. You can see the tongue, the teeth, and the back of the mouth. We're gonna leave this alone. You can edit it. I personally edit it, but it's not necessary, especially for starting out. Same with this one, it's the white of the eyes. What we're gonna wanna work on is maybe the eye line, which is this line here. You can adjust it if you want the colors to be a particular color. I tend to go with full blacks. And then you can take your tools over here, which is a brush tool, erase tool, blur tool, and just draw in how you want it to look. Over on the side, on the right-hand side, it allows you to adjust the width and opacity along with the layer properties. If you put on the mirror, it'll allow you to do both halves at the same time. That's actually not what I wanted to do. I'm gonna make sure I have the eraser tool selected. I'm gonna erase this right there. So it merges in a little bit. And you can do this with the tablet or you can just do it with your mouse. Yeah, we're just gonna do something simple. I don't wanna do too much work on these eyes. Just add a little extra at the bottom. It's fine. We're gonna go to the lashes. And the lashes come out from the eye and the body. They're a little bit harder to predict as far as how they'll move and be positioned on the body. Lashes, like anything else, you know, need to be adjusted. I'm gonna put them down to black. So we have black lashes. And I'm gonna erase most of them. I'll keep the ones at the end and I'll keep the ones at the beginning. And that's it. So we have the ones back here and then the ones up front. We can change the eyebrow color. I'm gonna go with a red with a black shader. Or I can even change the shape of the eyebrow. Let's do this. Yeah, it's just something simple. I don't want to add like a little weird design there. Got a little weird design on her eyebrows. Yeah, it's fine. Next we have the iris. These, of course, are the eyes. These ones you'll definitely want to change. It's actually easier to draw them outside of the program. And if you want to do that, you just right-click on the default image. And you're going to want to do export. A window will pop up. And it'll allow you to export it wherever you want. Or you can right click, or after you're done editing, you can right click and then do import. And then you can find your eyes and import them in. The next is the eye highlight, which are these yellow things here, the white and yellow things. I don't personally like these, so I tend to erase them. I also turn the mirror mode off for this, as it doesn't, as it flips it instead of how you would expect or anticipate it to look. And then I just draw in my own. Finally, is the face skin. This is what the skin looks like when it's laid out flat. Here you can adjust the tone using the base skin, which allows you to make things look darker or lighter. And then the shade color. similarly allows you to adjust things to look darker later. I tend to go with a more brownish tone for the skin. Maybe a little more pink. Right about there. Yeah, right about there. And you can edit the face here. I'm going to quickly jump over to General Editor and remove the shading by bringing the width all the way down and the hardness all the way up. So let's jump back to Face Editor. This way you get to clean slate and you get to see what you're working with. Forgive me for a lot of jumping around. I tend to do these in a very particular order, and it's more complex first and simpler last. But we'll go back to the skin, and here you can adjust things and draw things on the skin. What I personally recommend is not using this default skin at all. I find that the default skin is another marker, is actually the main marker of seeing like an amateur modeler. But that doesn't mean you have to put too much effort into it. Even if it's something as a flat color. Alright, what are you doing? Okay. So let's take this and let's just color. I've went to a new layer. So the default layer has the skin. I went to a new layer. And I'm just going to color over everything and just make it as flat as possible. And I know that's boring, but we're going to add in a little detail. And since it's on a new layer, if you lower the opacity, you can still kind of see where everything is located on the other layers. What I'm going to do is I'm going to grab a slightly darker layer and a smaller brush. Much smaller brush. And I'm going to draw on this. To move this around, you're going to want to hold shift and the middle mouse button to move it around and the scroll wheel to zoom in. So what I'm going to work on is drawing in a mouth, which let me undo that and put the mirror mode on. I'm going to give it a bit in the corner so she'll look like she's smiling, and then just drag it across. I'm going to give her a little dot for nose. And I'm going to bring the opacity back up to full so I can see what I'm working on. I'm just going to adjust the nose shape. And I'm going to add some lipstick, maybe? Really red lipstick, apparently. And add some red lipstick here. And maybe because I'm feeling... Yeah, I add some shine to that lip. It's something. It looks different than the default model. But this is slightly more advanced, is working on editing this face in this manner. And you can always like lower the opacity so you still have some of the other features, or even just a mixture of the two features. So here it is, the one that we did. Here it is without anything. And here it is just kind of like somewhere in the middle. So it looks different. There's something about it that still looks different. It still looks like a Vroid model, but something about it looks a little different. I guess we could talk about the brush properties. I feel this is fairly self-explanatory. We have a color picker. We have different brush shapes. Which is a hard brush and a soft brush are the two ones you'll mainly use. This one's kind of like a scattered brush, and this is an angled brush. A chiseled, well, it's not chiseled, but an angled brush. when you come down here, you can adjust the size of your brush. You can have a small brush, you can have a large brush, the opacity of the brush, so like something barely appears versus absolutely appearing. And then the layer opacity or the blend mode. It's just fun to mess around. Alright. So these textures are available in everything. It's available in the hair texture section. And if you want to know about my hair textures, I have an entire tutorial on that. And if for some reason, like, you want more than one texture, you can just go over here, hit duplicate, and then change the new texture to something else. And now we have a new texture in there. Easy peasy. The body editor, you can also edit the texture of. It'll be very similar to the face editor. If for some reason you want socks or underwear on your character, that's going to be drawn directly on this. Also, give Vroid a second. It's a slow program. You're going to draw it directly on the skin. Or gloves as well. And maybe even an undershirt. Clothing is where you can do a lot more detailing work. It also allows you to work with some transparencies to give unique designs. So here we have a base dress. Let's give it a color of, a green maybe? Now we'll go with a blue. Blue looks fine. Alright. And you can draw a pattern right here on the texture, and you can see it appear over here. Or, if you want, you can just draw on the texture. I'm going to undo that. One of the things you can do is erase things. And this will allow you to have a lot more options when it comes to working with clothes. So I just erase a ribbon. Let's say I want to only use the top and I don't want the dress part. I can then take this and just erase it. Mind you, I have the mirror tool on, which is why both sides of this texture is doing this. There we go. And let's say I want to do like a little heart cutout right here. Yeah, just like that. So now she has like a little heart cutout in her shirt. And if I want to change the shape of, say, the sleeves, so they're kind of like more scalloped, I can do that too. And then I just erase what I don't need. Keep in mind I'm doing all of this tutorial with a mouse. I do have a drawing tablet, and I recommend using it for when creating textures. But this is to show that you can absolutely make a model. Without it. And there you see that now she has scalloped sleeves. Oops. Let's go down to pants. And let's change the color of the pants to like a gray. We'll do this shader to a gray too. Similar to the other, you can adjust how you want it. Let's undo mirror mode, and we're going to make these kind of like shorts. And make this one super short. And this one, not as short. kind of like an off asymmetrical pattern, and we'll give a cutout in this pants here and here. Then we come down to sneakers, and we can adjust the sneaker color. Take the eyedropper and pick the same color as the shirt. Oops, that was the wrong one. With the shade here. Alright, and if you click here, you can see the basic design. I'm going to take a dark gray, and I'm going to color these laces here. And you can see down here that the laces are now gray. I'm going to just kind of draw carefully over the laces here. I put mirror mode back on so it mimics both sides. And now I have given her gray laces, or black laces. And that's how you would edit the clothes. I'm gonna go back into body editor, and I'm going to get rid of the socks, because socks look weird with this. So we're back over here in the body editor. And I'm going to grab any tone that I want for the body. And I'm just going to paint her legs. Completely the same color. You can edit it down if you want. Like I did with the thing, lowering it down. But I just want, you know, the base color. It's fine. Beautiful. And over here we have, still see some of her socks, which I'm actually okay with seeing some of her sock. I'll curve it like this so it looks like she's got crew cut socks on. And this doesn't actually match like the rest and how the tone goes, but you can fix that by just drawing it in yourself if you really want to. Yeah, so you just slowly kind of add in the shading that you want. And if you need to draw it directly on, you can too. And there we have it. We've added custom textures on top of this particular character. I think at this point, you're pretty much done to export the character now that you've made yourself a custom model. The one thing I do recommend, however, is this is a very good start, and I definitely think if you can get to this point, you've done very well for yourself. But keep practicing with the program. There's so many things that you can actually do with this program. You can make accessories using the hair. You can add more details to the clothes. If you take the clothes out of the program, you can add logos and stuff to them and just import them back in like you did with the other textures. Unfortunately, if you import a texture and you can't move it on the clothes once it's inside the program, it's very limited in that respect. But with just a little bit of practice, you can make your own model using Vroid. It's not that difficult. I hope this has helped you out in learning how to start up Vroid. I am Argama Witch, and if this video has helped you, give it that like and all that other jazz, and I will see you later. Goodbye.